And for more on this, we go to retired Colonel David Lamb, former chief of staff to the Combined Forces Command in Afghanistan in 2004 and 2005. He's now a professor at National Defense University. And James Dobbins, former special envoy to Afghanistan in 2001, and he's now at the RAND Corporation. Welcome to you both. Colonel Lamb, is this a conscious strategy to target Taliban leadership at the same time you're making it easier for them to go to talks?
It is. And to bring them to talk, they have to be compelled to do so. And the only way you're going to compel them to come in is by force. There are four red lines. They need to, number one, renounce violence; two, lay down their arms; three, renounce al-Qaeda; and then abide by the laws and constitution of Afghanistan.
But what is the thinking behind this? I mean, are you targeting the very guys you want to come talk? Couldn't that be counterproductive?
No, because in simple terms, they have to be compelled to come talk. On the battlefield right now, without the military pressure, they would sense that they were winning. Somebody who's sensing they're winning has no impetus at all to come and talk and bargain away anything. So force is one way to compel them to get to the table.
What explains this approach, in your view?
Well, I think we'd probably be targeting the Taliban leadership even if we weren't prepared to talk to them. I think that says more about the availability of the targets and the drones. But I do think that it can contribute to the possibility of a negotiation and a negotiated outcome. I think the administration's interest in pursuing that possibility comes from President Karzai's desire to do so, the government of Pakistan's new desire to try to help mediate a settlement, pressure from our allies. The British have been pushing this point for a long time, and a view that the military situation in Afghanistan is not going to get a lot better, so that if there is a point at which you have an equilibrium in which both sides feel there's a stalemate and neither side can win, you're as close to it as you're likely to get.
So NATO forces are trying to make this Taliban leadership feel under threat? Is that the idea?
Precisely.
That if they don't come talk, they might lose their lives?
Exactly, precisely. And the targeting is fairly sophisticated. They'll look at top leadership, some mid-level leadership, probably leave the low fence sitters alone, what we would call folks that were on a traditional kind of a white list that were just Taliban because it was the thing to do in the neighborhood at the time. But the key leadership is specifically targeted.
Now, are these leaders that are being targeted in Afghanistan, Pakistan, or both?
Well, both, but largely what they're talking about are in Afghanistan, I believe. And the leaders that are being targeted are not actually the ones that will ultimately negotiate with. They're the intermediate leadership, but the intermediate leadership is clearly critical, and to the extent they're being steadily eliminated, it is putting pressure on the system as a whole.
But that does raise the point. I mean, the ultimate Taliban leadership, Colonel Lamb is believed to be in Pakistan, Mullah Omar and his top lieutenants. So what is the connection between taking out their commanders in Afghanistan and them?
Well, you take away their operational arm and their ability to affect anything inside Afghanistan by going after these the mid-level folks. At the same time, There's pressure in Afghanistan. I mean, there is continual pressure with the drones. I know they've moved further north into Waziristan.
You're talking about in Pakistan.
And north Waziristan inside Pakistan. In fact, the last drone attack in Khorum authority area killed some Pakistani officers and precipitated some close down. So there's some give and take back and forth, good and bad with the drone attacks. But the pressure exists in sanctuaries and for the operational arm on the battlefield in Afghanistan.
Now, initially, the Obama administration was fairly cool to this idea of high-level talks. I mean, they were fine about reintegrating the low-level guys. What's turned that around, and to what degree does the deadline that President Obama set of July 2011 for at least U.S. forces to begin drawing down in some fashion driving that?
I think President Obama's statement that he'll begin drawing down in 2011 has caused everybody who's concerned to begin thinking about the end game and positioning themselves for something beyond the war. That certainly clearly applies to Karzai, who has embraced this, and a large element of Afghan society has embraced it, although it's still controversial. Our allies, the Pakistanis, have come forward, and there's a new interest on the part of the Taliban. Everybody, I think, tends toward the view that General Petraeus repeatedly says, that is, this is the only way it's going to end. It's going to take a long time to end it, so we might as well get started.
Has this gotten started, though, earlier than it might have, Colonel Lamb, if it weren't for this July 2011 deadline?
I think the July 2011 deadline is an impetus to get things moving. The downside of the 2011 deadline is that while it may be forcing some people to come and to talk and to get serious about what an endgame is, the problem with the 2011 deadline is that they may also be planning an endgame that is not in the interest of NATO or the regional actors, i.e. a re-beginning of a great game where they use Afghanistan as strategic depth for India and Pakistan and a proxy war in Iran and so on and so forth. So,
well, and also, why wouldn't the Taliban leadership just hunker down?
Well, with the July deadline, they in fact, a strategy would be just to hunker down, maintain the status quo, and then wait the alliance out.
So, bottom line, what do you think are the prospects for success on this particular two-pronged strategy?
I mean, I think that if you look at the history of, you know, the ends of civil wars, you're likely to take a long time to get into negotiations. It'll take a year of talks about negotiations till you're in negotiations. It'll then take several years for the negotiation to reach a conclusion. During that time, violence is likely to increase as the sides maneuver for advantage, and the side that emerges best is going to be the side that demonstrates the greatest tenacity.
And brief final thought from you on prospects for success?
Well, I tend to concur with Ambassador Dobbins, and that is, as this thing winds down, generally in these sorts of situations with these insurgencies, you're talking 10, 15, 20 years before one side finally wins, and then you get to real reconciliation.
Thank you both, David Lamb, James Dobbins.